The topic for today is learn how to quickly improve your forecast. So as I said, I'm Stéphane Leclerc, so I'm running this company. I will be with Thomas Robert in this webinar. He will be acting as a moderator. So if you have any question, feel free to add them. So you have some tools available. So he will be able to answer on the fly, or we'll have also a Q&A session at the end, a 15-minute Q&A session. So we will also take some questions for the end. Okay. So about the agenda. So we had a website, I mean, where it was listed. But before we start, actually, I will go through a quick company overview. Then I will describe quickly what we do and what we offer as a value to our customer. Then I will introduce the demand forecasting framework that we support. And then we'll move to a SKU Science demo of the process that we support. And as I said, we'll have this 15-minute Q&A session. So SKU Science, actually, it's a company that we created in July 2018. So we launched the platform in its first version in approximately also June 2019, so 1 year after. And currently, we have more than 200 accounts from 46 countries using the platform. And when we started the company, we had in mind, you know, that we wanted to offer some tools with a subscription plan that would be accessible for any type of budget, from the small company to a large one. And that's why actually we have users, you know, and we have plans ranging from 50 SKU or 50 forecasts up to 100,000 SKUs. So, and we have users in many industries, so including the retail, the healthcare industry, the food industry, manufacturing, agriculture, and telecom. And we have a nice quote from one of our customers, Bridgestone Australia, which basically states publicly that they benefited from the technology in particular, and they had a lot of gains by using the multi-level forecast edition capabilities that I will demonstrate right after during the webinar. Okay. So I assume you visited our website, but what we do in short, so first we help you get your demand forecast very rapidly and very easily. This is one of the main values that we bring. Also, we generate automatically, and you'll see that, all the forecast KPI in order for you to track the accuracy of your forecast and according to your specific operation lead time. And this is really key, and I will explain later on some, I mean, why it's very important to focus on certain KPI and not all of them. So I will show this later. Also, we allow you to automatically value those forecasts according to specific rules that may be related to the volume, the quantity, or some financial impact on your business. So we automatically compute this ABC class calculation. And then you can really focus on improving the forecast accuracy for your top sellers versus, you know, spending time improving your low runners, where it doesn't bring a lot of value, even if you really improve your forecast accuracy by maybe 20%. So really, the idea is really to focus on what really matters for your business. And last but not least, we provide ways to create custom reports. You'll see very rapidly, and every data that we generate in the tool can be exported and reused in any other tool that you may have in-house. So the values that we bring to our customers, so of course, since you will improve your forecast, the idea is to reduce the number of stockouts that you'll get in your operations. So this will increase your revenue. And of course, since you can also optimize your stock levels, you will increase your cash flow and free up some working capital that you can reuse for other activities in your company. So you'll notice also that we have a very nice way to modify or being able to edit your forecast. So you will see some savings up to 80% of your time, because you can impact many forecasts from just changing one value. And I will show you that. So this is very powerful, and clearly you have a lot of time savings here you can get. And you'll see that the way to start with SKU Science is very easy, because you don't need to go for a mandatory integration like with many other platforms. You have an easy setup, and you can play with all the parameters. So even if you're not an expert, I mean, you'll see a lot of benefits from you using the platform, because it's fully automated and everything, all the numbers, you know, come directly to you. But if you are an expert in forecast, you can also play with those parameters and bend the platform a little bit to tune and really make sure you have some forecasts that are satisfying for your activity. So now I'm going to use this opportunity to introduce this four-dimension demand forecasting framework, which actually will be presented in more detail, if you're interested, next week by one of our founders, Nicolas Van de Put. So he will host a dedicated webinar just explaining this part and giving you more details. But what I'd like to highlight today is that we, with SKU Science, we fully support this this framework. Okay. So for example, I will insist during the tool demonstration about every single aspect of this framework. And in particular, the temporality, which is where you will define your cycle period, whether you work in time buckets, in weeks or in months. This is something which is important and that you need to define upfront, according to your supply chain. Also, I will spend some time explaining the granularity. So with us, you can work at different granularity. And what is really important is to define the lowest granularity that you want for your forecast, because once you have it, it's very easy to move at some level ups and actually modify and get a vision of your forecast at a much higher level and see the impact even working at lower level. So there is, I will spend some time explaining this during the presentation. Also, your process internally is very key, because we generate forecast and some baseline, but no one knows your business better than you. So you will need to interact with your peers, with your customers, with your suppliers, and we'll modify the forecast according to a certain process that you may have in-house, like a sales and operation planning process. And but what we bring to you is all the metrics and the KPI that will allow you to track whether or not those change and the process that you have set up will actually are beneficial to your business, or and if you increase and improve the performance of your forecast, or if you bring some noise and probably you even decrease the value and the time that you spend is less interesting for you. So this is something that I will highlight during the presentation. And now actually I'm done with the slide. So I will go with the tool and show you how to use it as a regular user. I will put myself in your shoes and I will start with as if I just open an account in 5 seconds. Okay, and I will show you how it works, okay? So now I'm transitioning to the tool. So you can see that by default, normally when you join the platform, you actually, by default, you are set in demo data mode. So you have a set of 10 items that you can see here. And basically this is something that allows you to play with the tool and become familiar with the interface. But at one point, what's really valuable for you is to put your own data in the system. So you have two options. You have either you go here from your from the quick start guide and you have a direct import, which allows you to launch the first import wizard, which is a particular wizard because I mentioned the temporality aspect earlier, and this is where you define your cycle period. Okay, so this is very important. Normally you do this only once, which is somehow reset the database, reset your account, and you'll see that this is where we define the cycle period. Okay, so the tools tells me that I'm going to switch from demo mode to my own personal accounts. So I confirm this, and this is where actually you will define your temporality. So whether you will work on at the week level or on the month level, and this is where you define this part. So it's very important at the beginning to make sure you understand which cycle you want to work with. So in my case, I will select calendar months. Okay. And my fiscal year in January, I also set the currency. So if I go next, I will go and select my Excel spreadsheet. So basically you have two kinds of spreadsheet that you can use and you can refine from, that our customer are using. So you have the first part, which is basically you have all your orders in one flat file. So all your orders for a specific period. And if I select this one, so the tool start to analyze the file, and I have several sheets, so I select the first one. Okay, and now it's analyzed, and basically the tool automatically detects that I have some, in this particular file, I have some dates, some information, and I have my volume and units. And so when I say we have two different type of files, because sometimes you'll have this kind of file where you have one column with all your dates and all your orders somehow, and the units on the right, okay? whereas you have another five that I will describe right after, okay? But I will go through this one. So normally, automatically, the tool detects where your dates are located. Keep in mind that your date should be in one single column, not two columns, okay? So here, you know, this is the case. If you see a bad selection, you can change and select another one, okay? So it's really convenient, but here my dates are in this column. And you see on the right, all my units are also properly selected. So this is how this is working now. But here, you know, regarding the dates, there may be some ambiguity in particular. It could be weeks instead of months in this case. So the tool asked me to check that I'm satisfied with the fact that this is months and year. So actually you can see that the formatting date is well analyzed. So this is exactly what I want. And then based on your geography, you may have a different settings in your file, and we can use different types, you know, of format for numbers. So automatically the tool normally detects the right number. So here I'm in Europe, okay, and this is the number that is detected, but I can change it if I notice any issue. And regarding the fields in my file, actually now I have part numbers and location, and I have a third field, which is customer. And by default, so this is my file on the left, and on the right, you know, this is what's in the SKU Science account. So by default, we just have a few number of fields. We don't have many, okay? We just provide you five fields, three that are general, like part number, location, description, that are very common in many industries, and plus that are related to your finance if you want to compute some financial data. But we provide, in this particular case, I have a customer field, which is really specific to my business, and I want to add it. So it's very easy. You click on add new field, customer. It's a text field in the general section. I don't set any units, and I confirm. Okay, so automatically you'll see that I have a new field that I created for my particular account, where actually I will add this information in my forecast. Okay. Then this part is related to the granularity of the forecast. So I won't spend time during this first upload. The idea is really to show you how it works, but I will spend some time during the second upload. And then you have at the bottom the ability to check actually that the upload process is satisfying, and that you can recognize your data before pressing the confirmation button here. Okay, so I can see that this is exactly what I wanted. So I click confirm, and automatically you'll see at the top there is the upload process has started. So I don't have many data. So if I click, and now I can see that I have 10 items that I've loaded. Okay, so this is the process to actually load the data, and automatically going to the first item. Actually, so I've loaded the blue dots, okay, which is my historical demand. And you can see that the red dots actually is the forecast that is automatically computed by the tool, okay? So I won't spend some more time on this one. I will show you now what is the second type of file that you may use in order to get your data, okay? So what I do is I have my camera. So I reset the database. I go back, I start from scratch again, okay? And I will show you, so you see my database is empty, and I'm going to import now a new type of file, which is the second one that you may own, probably. Where in this case, I have my dates are in the file header. So it's a different type of file, okay? You see I have some fields again to describe my activity, my part number, which territory, which channel, which customer, and which family. But you will see automatically the tool detects that I have some dates now in the file header here. And so I have a large amount of data that I will upload, okay, more than 2 years. We recommend always to load more than 2 years, because if you want to detect seasonality, this is what you need in order to get this analysis by the tool, okay? So the date format here, there is no ambiguity, okay, because the tool knows automatically what it is. But you'll still have many options, so you can really select it. You can use a custom format, and you can even use a calendar style to change any date format that may cause you any problems. I still have the quantity, which is okay, it's green. And now regarding the fields, okay, I can see that I can recognize my customer field that I created previously during the first import. And now quickly, I will also add new information like the channel. So you'll see it's very easy to customize it, okay. I have this new field channel and also this new field family that I want to create. Okay, now add this. And now that I've spent some time explaining how to set up the file, I will spend some time explaining how we work and which granularity we will select, okay? So by default, you see that the tool automatically proposes that we work at the part number level, but we have several options. And since I have created some other fields and I have some other information, for example, I may decide to have something even at a lower level of granularity, which could be part number customer, okay? So if I do this, I will create a forecast at the part number customer level, okay? I can also add a dimension, let's say, if I have a big customer in several territories and I want to add another level of granularity, which is a country level, so I can also, for example, add the location, okay? So I will create a forecast which will be at the part number, customer, and location level, okay? Like you may have this, some distribution center or warehouses, whatever, but you have many options. Or the shop, if you have many shops, you may want to do this at the shop level. So this is how you combine these fields to create the forecast at this level. So that's the granularity point, okay? So now in my case, I will select part number customer, okay? And you will see again at the bottom, you can check before the upload that you can find all your columns, okay? All the one that you will import. And actually it seems to be okay. So I launch the confirmation. And now automatically, again, the tool, you see it at the top. It's upload all this data. You organize the data according to certain rules. And you can see now that I have a name which is composed of the part number plus a customer name, okay? So again, if I click on this particular item, I can see that this is automatically, I mean, there's a forecast which is automatically computed. But we won't do this one by one because we have 100 and we can have even more. So we have one way to compute the forecast for all these items. So going here, clicking on the rocket icon, automatically the tool has detected that my first forecast period is in July because I loaded the demand data up to June. And the forecast horizon will be set to 12. So I can set it to even more if I wish or less. This is one option. And also we have the ability. So in this case, the default is that SKU Science will compute all the forecast, but you may also decide that you will use some external forecast at one point. This is one option that we provide. And also you will see that there is an ABC class computation option, which is checked. This means that automatically after the forecast calculation, the tool will based on certain rule, compute some ABC class and organize your forecast according to certain weight, which allows you to see which one are the more important for your business. So if I click confirm, you'll see that there is a new activity and this is already done. And so you'll see now in this particular column, ABC percent, I have all the percentage that has been computed by the tool. And you'll see, for example, that this one seems to be according to the rules that I've set up, seems to be the most important one for my business, this particular part number and this customer. Okay, so if I click on it, I can see some particular information, like of course my historical data plus the forecast that has been computed by the tool automatically. You see it has been selected from this list, okay? And all the parameters also of the forecast are accessible. So you can tune them if you wish, although we don't recommend it. But this is one level. So if you recall well, we created this forecast from the lowest level, which is the part number customer level, okay? But we also have the ability to do some change now. If I want to modify based on some discussion I have, because I'm the expert and I know that this data, it won't be this, I want to increase it a little bit, okay? I can adjust this data very easily and you'll see that there is some impact graphically. So you can change it at this level, okay? So at the lowest level. Now I'm gonna show you also that you can change this data at a higher level directly. So I will move to this tool, which basically allows you to edit massively all your data. So you see all your information. So at the lowest level, which is still part number and the customer level. And you can notice, you know, that the data that have changed at the lowest level is highlighted in red. This is to let you know that actually this one has been modified and is not the baseline, but you can see the baseline data just by clicking here, okay? You also have the ability to now to work at a higher level. So in this case, I want to have a different point of view. which is a part number level. So I don't care about the. I want something more aggregated, and so I move one level up to the part number level. Okay, and you can see still that the data that I have changed at the lowest level is still visible here. Okay, and but I can change any data. For example, here, if I change this data and I say, let's say I want to increase it by 10%. I type 110%, and automatically you'll see it's this forecast that I've changed at the part number level will downstream to all the other underlying forecasts. So we can go back and check this point. Okay, so here you see this is the impact from the what I've just done at the higher level. Okay, and you can see that this one, which belongs to the same family, somehow also has some impact. Okay, so you can see that by changing it at a different level, I have impacted all my underlying forecasts according to the weight that they represent for this specific period. Okay, so now I will go back to the granularity discussion. So granularity, as I said, we did it from the lowest level, okay, which is the part number. We computed all the forecasts from part number customer level. But we also have the ability to compute the forecast at a much higher level, because when you have more data, more quantity, normally your forecast is supposed to be more accurate. So if you click on this button, we can launch a forecast computed from this particular organization. So if you see this number, okay, you'll see that this is actually the sum from all the underlying forecasts. So you'll see it will be modified. So if I do this, and I click forecast at aggregate level, automatically the tool launch a new session of computation, and you see that now this data has been updated, okay? So we have the ability to show you the historical demand for this particular part number. You can also see the new forecast data, okay? And clearly you see there's been some impact. What actually did the tool do during this calculation? It has also an impact on the lowest level. So if we go back and check now what happened to the one at the lowest level, you see it's no longer the one that has been computed before. It's coming from the aggregation. So this is how you can see that you can impact your forecast starting from a higher level. Okay, you can go back to something which is the one which is computed at this level. Okay, and I can add the aggregation level if I want to compare two graphs directly from here. Okay, so this is one option that we bring. Okay, and we can go back to the aggregation if you wish. So that's it for the granularity. So I explained the various granularity, how you can edit, modify this, how you can even create your forecast at different granularity levels, keeping in mind that you need to define the lowest level that is interesting for you. But you can then, this is how you can get those forecasts, modify any value, and then decide which one to use in your organization. Okay, so I've been through this. And now I'm going to move to the process itself and to the metrics. Okay. So if I go to the KPI tab, you'll notice that we have no information here because actually we just have one forecast, which is the one that we created. Okay. So I will show you what happens when let's project ourselves in 1 month from now. Okay. And now we are actually in July. Or August, I would say. Let's add another demand period. Okay, let's consider that we are 1 month in the future, and we have actually now some more data. So I'm launching, for the convenience of this demo, a particular file which contains several periods, but we'll actually just pick one. Okay. So the tool is analyzing the file, and actually I'm interested just to load this July period. Okay, so we have now the data from July. Okay, I will import this data. So since I'm working at the part number customer level, I also need to make sure that I have part number and customer. Okay, and now I confirm the import. So I'm just uploading a new period, which is a July, and you'll see that now if I go back to the KPI part, I need to launch a forecast first. So I need to launch a forecast. So I compute the forecast for all my items. And if I go back to the KPI, I can see now that I have some data, okay? So I won't spend time here to explain this data, but you can also see that if you go back to your forecast, now you can see your former forecast, okay? So keep in mind that in red, you have the one that has been computed just right now after I uploaded my new demand data from July, okay? But I can see, you can see that the former forecast has been automatically archived, okay? And this is important because this will give us the ability to track those KPI, okay? So now I will show you, I mean, let's consider again that we are one step in the future. I'm going to launch again another period, okay? So I will upload now, let's say August. You see, I can unselect the period that are not interesting for me. I upload August, same for the rest. Just need to add customer here. I confirm. Now I launch the forecast starting from September, as you can see. And automatically, you can see that I have now, if I go back to this item, I have now two forecasts here. Okay. For example, I can see the one from July, the one from August. And I can see now in KPI, I have two more. I have an additional column that with additional data, okay, that has been automatically populated. So I will change my account and show you an account where actually I've loaded many more forecast data, and I will show you. I will explain from here. Okay, so in this particular account, you'll see that I have six. More forecasts, actually six forecasts that has been actually archived, okay? And here, when you click now on lag, you'll see that I have many more information that is available. So I will explain the concept of lag before going into the detail of this table, but this is very important to understand why we are doing forecast, okay? So basically we do forecast because we want to take some actions that will impact our supply chain, right? So actually if we want to have this data, I mean, some data, some products accessible in December, we need to make sure that we need to estimate this amount of data in December. And if we need to get this product from, let's say, a manufacturer which will take 2 months to deliver those data, I need to plan this data 2 months in advance, okay? So if I need to ship, let's say, if I sell t-shirts, and I want to get my t-shirt from China or Bangladesh, it may take 4 months to ship those t-shirts actually from to my place in order for me to sell them. Okay, so actually this delay is very important. So what is interesting here is if you're playing at this 4 months level, okay, which is to understand what does it mean, this lag zero, lag one, lag two. So lag zero means actually that we plan in December, okay, the data of December. Okay, so if I go back to lag one, this means that we take the forecast from November in that case. So it's still, we're still talking about the same period of December. Okay, so we are still comparing this data, which is the real demand of December, but from the forecast of November for this particular period. If I move to lag two, again, I compare the real demand of December, but with the forecast that I created in October for the December period. And I see, so if you see at the bottom here, you see that every time I change, okay, although I'm always comparing the same demand data, I don't have the same value because I'm not comparing with the same forecast, okay? And this is very key to understand where you should focus your effort to improve your forecast accuracy, because actually you need really to determine which lag is important for you, because this is the one that is critical for your business operations, okay? So this is something that is very key. And if I was not very clear, just drop me an email and probably we can spend more time to explain this. But this is very important for you to understand at which lag you want to work with. And this is really related to the lead time of your operation when you need to get those units, you know, on your shelves. Okay. So now that I explained the lag, I will explain what you can see in this table. So first, there is the bias. So what we call the bias, basically, it's a signed error. So you can see that we have minus here, you have plus here. So it's really the signed error, okay? Then we also display the bias in percent, okay? So we actually, we compute it according to the real demand data. You can have the absolute error as well. And then we have the accuracy, which is the complementary information, I mean, from the error up to 100%, okay? So you'll see here, for example, 15%, 85, okay? It's just the complementary information. You can also see that you have some color coding in every cells. It's because we have some specific rules that are associated to any threshold. So you can customize these thresholds. I will show you how, okay? So you have some rules and you can set your KPI threshold according to your own expectation. And this is how you can actually set it up and save it. So those thresholds, actually, you can see them also when you're moving to the, let's say, to the graphical part. So here we are displaying, you know, this information graphically. And you see on the right, you have all these thresholds that are actually displayed. So now, talking about the process and also I'm going to introduce the notion of forecast value added, okay? So you can see at the bottom, there is this information which is captured here. So in every part of this table, we actually have several several lines, okay? So what does it mean? Basically, the SKU science actually information is the one from the baseline. So it's the one that is computed automatically by the tool, okay? And we compare the forecast that is generated by SKU science against the real demand, okay? So you see, for example, in this one, in this case, we've been 8,000 units above the real value, okay? Then as a user, you may have changed the data. Well, this is not the case in December, but if you look at, let's say July, actually in this exercise, I did some change to really highlight how this is working. You can see that I did some modification. I adjusted some value in the forecast. And actually I have a better bias than the one that was generated by the tool, okay? And basically you see in green, so I've improved this value by this amount, okay? So you see, this is a positive impact. My change is positive. So you can see it for the bias, you can see it for the error, and also from the accuracy level point of view. So you'll see from various point of view, okay? So I will show you the next one, where basically this is not the case. In this case, in particular, I have did some change, but you know, instead of improving the forecast, actually for this particular period in lag zero, I degraded the forecast. So my change were not positive because actually my anticipation were actually worse than what happened in the reality. So this is a way for you to really track if you change in the forecast are really beneficial for your business or not, okay? And you can get this information. You'll see you just need to switch and you get all these steps that are recomputed automatically based on your life, okay? So that's how you move from this point and how you can change and analyze your information. You can see it also from the average perspective, but your goal should be normally to improve the accuracy, you know, from one period to another one to a specific line. That should be your real objective for your demand forecasting exercise, okay? Well, not only we provide this data at the lowest level, but you'll see we also are able to provide this data, you know, at different levels. So if I combine, let's say I want to see what is my accuracy per customer. Okay, I select customer, you see automatically I can organize the data. So you'll see that customer 44 is my top customer, okay? And if I want to analyze, similarly, I can play with this lag element. Let's say I'm interested to see what is my lag 1 month prior, you know, my forecast. So I select lag one. And if I click on this one, I can see the full table, okay? And I can compare, you know, even the blue line is a SKU Science one against the red one. So you see for this particular period, we have different data, but you can see whether or not you're better than the tool. And this is really important for you, okay? So we can do this at this level, at any level. You can also combine various fields together like customer location. Okay, so you can get this information from many point of view, many perspectives, and this really gives you the ability to analyze your forecast. And the more forecast you will get, actually, the easier it will be to improve them and really take some actions internally in your process? I mean, to better, discuss with specific part of your organization to make sure that you can really improve the this particular accuracy. Okay, and you can sort them. You can do this info. So if I select part number, you know, I can see very rapidly which one is the most important one. And if I'm doing well for this particular part number. Okay, so now I've spent, I cover most of the topics, but there is one point that I need again to go through, which is the reports. I didn't spend much time on this one. So the reports actually is a way for you to access your data and to export them very rapidly. For example, I've created some reports prior to the webinar, like this one. So here, this is a report that automatically computes the forecast, part number and customer. So this is my lowest level of granularity. So if I click on this report, I can see that I have a table which automatically, you know, get all this information in one single file, and I can export this information in my file. So I will get a CSV file that I can use in Excel or Google spreadsheet, and you can play with this information very rapidly. So I will show you how to create a report. So to create a report, it's very, so you'll see your table here. This is really the field that will be appearing in your report. So you can see this field category here. So if you want, let's say, add some customer location, so you just click on the information, automatically you'll see it's populated. You can also decide to rearrange the order. So if you want to move it this way, I mean, or remove description, so you just need to move one column, you drag and drop them. You can also see that you can access your forecast data. Okay, so if you add this, you have all the forecasts that are automatically added. Okay, so I will remove them. You can also access your archive. Let's say you want to access your forecast from December. So you just need on this, you click refresh, and you have all the forecasts that you created in December. Okay, so this is really how you can populate and create custom forecasts. Just need to select your field. You add them, you go to the proper category. You can also filter some elements. So if you want just to see, you know, the customer information related to customer 44, you just add a filter, you go in your list, you select, you know, customer contains, let's say 44. Okay. Refresh preview, and you see I just skip this information. So this is a way you can really customize your report very rapidly. You can save them, you can organize them, and when you go there, you can see them. You just need to click. If you do any new upload of data, you want to get your forecast directly, you just need to click update report. The tool you see is computing this data, is organizing all the data based on your latest forecast. And actually, you'll see that now you have a new table which is up to date, and that you can export this data. Similarly, I have not shown you how to customize your view, but this is the same process. So you can create as many views to navigate into your forecast. In order to create a view, it's really similar. You have this interface. You select your fields, and then you just save the view, and you actually have the same type of interface. I think that's it for the presentation. So unless I forgot anything, but I don't think. So probably we can, although I'm 5 minutes early, probably we can move to the Q&A session. So I don't know if there's any many Q&A questions. I don't know, Thomas?
Yes, Stefan. Hi, everyone. So I answered some of the question typing, and I was just answering another about the lags. So Utkarsha is asking if you can explain a bit about lags, how it works and what it is. So actually I was starting to answer it, but I don't know, Stefan, if you want me to answer it, or if you want to elaborate on that.
I think we can go back to, I can spend more time explaining. I know this is not the most obvious concept to understand, because basically probably what we should do next time is show a table. But basically what you need to understand is you have several forecasts, okay? So in our case, if I go back here, you see we have, not here, we have six forecasts, okay? And for this, if I take, let's say I take July, okay? So if you go to the forecast that I created in July, okay, you can see that actually I have a data, which is this data, okay, that has been planned. So here you see the real demand data that now we have this data, so we can compare it. But when we created the forecast in July, we didn't have this data, okay? And we forecast this amount in July, okay? So if I go to August, you will see that the number still for December is different, okay? Because we updated the forecast and we had we planned a different data for December, okay? In September, for the forecast that we created in September, we also had a different value because basically we got some new data, so we were able, you know, to have a different version of the forecast. And because basically the closer you are to the period, normally the more accurate you are, okay? So it's easier to forecast when you're close to a period than when you are far from a period, okay? So normally your accuracy should be better when you're closer. That's why it's important to relaunch your forecast after every period, you know, to make sure you have some more accurate data. And so this is, although we are always comparing with the demand data in December, we don't always compare the same value. And we pick the data from the forecast that is interesting for us. Okay. So if we go to here we take the data from the forecast, which is the one from December. Lag zero means this is the same month. Lag one means this is the forecast we created 1 month earlier. So in November, I'm comparing with the forecast of November, but for the period of December. Here, I'm comparing with the forecast we created in October, okay? But still for the same period, okay? So I'm taking December from this forecast, okay? And because actually I want to track this 2 months in advance. I want to see if 2 months in advance, I'm able to have a good accuracy, because this is this particular actions that impact my business. Okay, if I'm not good at planning this one correctly, and if I miss this particular period, okay, actually I won't get the right amount of product for the right moment. So it's really an issue. I really need to make sure that this is where actually I spend my effort to improve the accuracy for this particular line. Because if I work can, particular lag, I will clearly get a better results.
It's maybe I just wanted to elaborate on that to precise that it should be related to your lead time actually. Actually, the lag should be generally equal to your lead time, because if you have a lead time of 2 months, it means that you need 2 months to make a product available. You need to be able to anticipate the demand you will have for this product 2 months in advance in order for you to, for example, produce it or store it or buy it and so on. Yeah. So basically the lag, you choose your lag based on your lead time. That's all I wanted to say. So maybe, Stéphane, you want the next question. So someone was asking, because you mentioned 200 plus accounts in the beginning, and someone is asking if those accounts are users.
Yeah, sure, yeah.
Okay. Another question I've got, yeah, well, it's not a question, it's more like a request for demonstrating a feature. It was a question about do we apply some pre-processing on the demand before forecasting? So the answer is no, we don't have automatic pre-processing of the demand, but we can still adjust the demand before forecasting to create a new basis for the forecast computation. And so the request was if you can show this feature, if you can show that we can adjust the demand before forecasting, please.
Yes. So this one. So I go to the, okay, so we are working on the forecast now. So so if I understand well the question, so the idea is that we let's say we want to adjust this information, correct? So it,
yes.
Okay. So because this is an outlier or something like that. So let's say the data, we identify that this data is not correct for how we want to drive the forecast. So I can replace, let's say, by this amount. Okay. If I validate this information, you'll see that the forecast is different. So we replace actually the data which has been uploaded during the process with this new data, and this drive actually a different forecast. So the forecast is different because we now use for the model this data instead of this one. This is also, there is one information that I didn't share with you, but during the, when we launch the forecast, we also have the ability, in particular if you experimenting some issue with the demand due to the COVID, and this may impact negatively your forecast because you have very low demand for this during this period. So you have the options to actually add this what we call the COVID-19 feature, but you can replace the demand automatically with some data that are computed by the forecast. So basically what it does, so you select your starting date. So normally it's in 2020, but let's say I want to start from, okay, it's for June. Okay, so if I select for June, I can select to replace for July, August, and September, the demand data that you see here, automatically the tool, if I launch with this option, will populate demand adjustment here in this, for this free period that I will actually define with new data that are automatically computed by the tool to actually have a better accuracy for your forecast. Okay. So you won't use the real demand for this particular period, but instead you will use some data that it will automatically compute based on how the data should have been due to a forecasting model. Okay, and it will replace and use those data instead to have a better projection. I don't know if this is very clear, but
thanks. That I think that covers what we can do about changing the adjusting the demand because computing forecast. I hope. Okay, it was Usman who asked the question. I hope it's clear for you. If not, you can tell us on the chat. And that was all, basically, the questions we had at the moment. So if you have other questions, you can send us. We can address it. We still have some time.
Or at least there's no more question.
Yeah, it seems there's no more question.
Okay. Okay. I hope the presentation was clear. So if you have any.
We have one question coming. So is the model automatically taken seasonality into account, or is it possible to turn it off?
But actually, normally it automatically detects the seasonality, but you can force the model. So if you don't want to use seasonality, or actually you can also normally play with the parameters. So you have, if you are familiar with those seasonality parameters, you can change them and turn them off. Yeah, I would say.
Yeah, you can even choose an algorithm without seasonality, right?
Yeah, you can force. You can force an algorithm, okay, like here, okay. But you can also, if you let the tool automatically pick the one, I mean, from the seasonality, you can also tune. Normally, you can change those parameters, and there is they will have an impact on the way the forecast will be computed. So I hope this answers the question. Okay, I think I don't see any other question coming.
No, I think that's it. But you can still, if you have if later you think about questions, don't hesitate to contact us either through the website or Stefan. Maybe we'll send the contact information also.
Sure. So that's the time then to conclude this webinar. So I hope you enjoyed it. And so again, as Thomas said, don't hesitate to ask us any other question if you think about them later. So thanks again for attending this webinar. And I think that's it for today then. And thank you a lot. Bye-bye.